哈利路亚，奉主耶稣圣名正道。
Hallelujah, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I speak the sermon.
啊，主所亲爱的，大家下午平安。
Brothers and sisters, whom the Lord Jesus loves, peace be with you.
啊，靠着圣灵的帮助，我们继续来分享、来讲解《使徒行传》的信息。
By the help of the Holy Spirit, we continue to share on the topic and the message from the Acts of the Apostles.
那么，从《使徒行传》看教会危机这个主题，我们讲到今天就已经是不同的题目了。
And when we were talking about the message from Acts of the Apostles with a different theme today.
我们从危机开始讲，一共讲了17堂。
The previous theme about the crisis of the church, we have already spent 17 sessions on
那特
that.
别魔鬼破坏教会的手段这个主题讲了10堂。
Especially in terms of the tactics and the schemes of the devil in destroying the church, we have spent 10 sessions to
那
elaborate
么，
on that.
从今天开始的每一章，我们从它的内容里面定出一个题目出来。
And from today onwards, in every chapter, we will be pointing out an important content.
好像今天第八章传道的题目就是"风雨中的教会，在风雨中的教会"。
And as I have entitled this chapter 8, As the Church Amidst the Storms.
那么因为我们要从这些题目当中去看到教会是如何在风雨中如何的发展，如何的在风雨中前进。
Because we are to study as to how the church is able to march on despite the storms and in difficult times.
那么风雨中的教会是一间怎么样的教会呢？
And how does the church in amidst the storms look like?
那么在风雨中的教会的表现又是如何的呢？
And what kind of demonstration can you see of the church in the times of storms?
那么从第八章一节说，除了使徒以外，教会遭受到八大逼迫。除了使徒以外，门徒都分散在犹太和撒玛利亚各处。
Chapter 8, verse 1 introduces to us that except the apostles, the rest of the believers have already been scattered in the regions.
那么这里特别注明哦，特别强调说，除了使徒以外。
It especially stated that it was except the apostles.
那么我们就讲了两个不同的解释。
And earlier we have talked about two different theories and explanations.
因为有人解释说，门徒是不可以离开耶路撒冷的，他们必须要在那边。
And the first explanation being, some people say that the apostles must not leave the Jerusalem church.
因为如果门徒跟其他的信徒一样分散在各处，那么耶路撒冷就散掉了，就群龙无首了。我们说没有领导人了。
Had the apostles also been scattered out of Jerusalem, then the whole church would have to collapse because there is no leader.
虽然他们没有离开耶路撒冷，
although they did not leave Jerusalem,
可是他们却随时要面临死亡的逼迫来到。
However, they were still exposed to the risk of a danger of a death.
这是他们的勇气跟他们的榜样。
And that's the courage and the role model that I have set for us.
这是第一种解释。
That's the first explanation.
那第二种解释。
Second explanation.
除了使徒以外，这句话似乎门徒们都没有受到很可怕的逼迫，似乎都没有。
This phrase, except the apostles, it appears that the apostles did not experience any persecution.
那第二种解释就是因为主耶稣用篱笆将他们围起来，保护他们不受到伤害。
And that second explanation goes that the Lord God has put up a fence of protection around the apostles.
这种篱笆保护的道理在约伯记可以看到。
And this teaching from the fence of God can be found in the book of Job.
这是第二种解释。
That's the second explanation.
第三种解释。
The third explanation.
为什么大家都受到逼迫？都分散在各处，唯独使徒们没有呢？为什么
？How is it that everybody else was already scattered throughout the regions except the apostles? Why?
第三种解释，我们就比较少考虑到的，甚至可能你没有什么可以接受的，可能你不太能接受的。
The third explanation may be one that you may not find acceptable.
但是我们根据圣经以及一些看到的事实，我们尝试来解释第三种解释。
But according to the Bible and also certain findings of evidence, we try to understand this explanation.
好，简单说，第三种解释就是这里的逼迫是攻击说希利尼化的那些信徒，是攻击说希腊化的那些信徒。
And in simple words, this persecution and attack were actually targeted to targeting Greek speaking Hellenist Jews.
就好像在第六章那些那一群哦，说希腊化的犹太人跟本土犹太人分成两个不同的这个。两个不同的两群人呐、啊。
Just as what we studied in chapter 6, that there were two camps of Jews, and the Hellenists or the Greek-speaking Jews, as well as the local Jews.
你试试看听这个解释，看你的感受是怎么样，试试听看。
You try to listen to this explanation and find out how you feel about it.
为什么只攻击说希利尼化的基督徒呢？
Why do they only attack and persecute the Hellenists or the Greek-speaking Jews?
所以那些本土犹太人，说纯正化的那些犹太人就没有受到怎么样的攻击，好像使徒们也没有受到怎么样的攻击。
While the local Jews and the authentic Jews, so-called, including apostles, were not persecuted.
第一个原因。
The first reason.
因为使徒们。以及本土的犹太人，他们本身就有很强的犹太教的立法观念，很强的犹太教的立法观念。
It is because the apostles, as well as the local Jews, Jewish believers, they already had a very strong foundation in terms of the Jewish laws and customs.
所以他们没有受到怎么样的攻击了。
Which is why they were not the target of this persecution.
因为真正攻击教会的，攻击主耶稣的。就是那些文士、法利赛人，就是纯犹太教的哦，纯犹太教的那些本土犹太人来的呀。
Because the ones who are persecuting the church happen to be the Pharisees and also the scribes who were also the pure Jews of the local Jews.
他们会攻击耶稣，要杀害耶稣。其中一个原因就是觉得主耶稣推翻了他们的律法观念呐、啊，律法的那些行为啊，所以他们很生气啊。
And this explanation argued that because they are angry with the fact that the church was trying to demolish the laws and ordinances, which is why it angered them.
那么说希利尼化的犹太人呢？他们比较没有这种犹太教很强的立法观念，比较没有这么强的观念。
And on the other hand, the Hellenist Jews or the Greek-speaking Jews, they did not have a very strong understanding and concept regarding the local or the Jewish laws and ordinances.
所以这些希利尼化说希利尼化的犹太人，对正统犹太人讲，他们不能接受的，他们不同意他们的，不赞成他们的。
Which is why they would disagree and not accept the usual customs practiced by the Jews.
那大家请注意哦。
Let us all take note.
那原因的第一种就是犹太教的立法观念很重。第一个原因。
The first explanation of this argument is that the Jewish customs was very strong.
第二个原因呢？第二个原因，使徒们本身呢、啊，他们自己对犹太教的观念那些立法也是很强，非常的执着。使徒们自己也很强的这种观念。
And the second reason of this theory is that even the apostles themselves have very strong understanding and concepts regarding the Jewish laws and customs.
那么使徒们啊，那么有一个雅各啊，耶稣的兄弟啊，亲弟弟，耶稣的兄弟雅各啊，就是代表这些犹太观念很强的代表性人物，是他们的领袖。
In fact, the brother of Jesus, James, has also been a very strong representative of the understanding of the Jewish customs.
我们怎么会这样讲呢？
Why do we deduce this?
你看那个加拉太书二章的答案。
Return to Galatians chapter 2, we will find an answer.
加拉太书第二章。
Galatians chapter 2.
加拉太书二章十一节到十四节。
Galatians chapter 2, verse 11 to verse 14.
这里说保罗他说 基法就是彼得到了安提阿的时候，他有一些行为 是可以责备的，那么保罗就责备他。
Here we can see that Paul was rebuking Cephas, which is Peter, who came to Antioch and rebuking him for certain behaviors.
哦，彼得基法到了安提阿，那就是外邦人的教会，外邦人的中心，很兴旺的教会。
And Antioch being a church, which is church of the Gentiles, because it is the center of the Gentile lands.
彼得在外邦人的教很外邦人的教会的中心，到底有什么地方被责备呢？到底有什么地方是不太正确的呢？
And what kind of misconduct or behavior that was found inappropriate by Peter? Of Peter.
12节。因为他看到从雅各那里来的人，从耶路撒冷属于雅各的人，哦，还没有来的时候呢，彼得跟这些外邦人啊，跟其他的弟兄姐妹啊，坐在一起吃饭，没有问题的，都 OK 的。
And before, in verse 12, before certain men came from James, Peter was having a meal with the Gentiles, and that was no problem.
但是到雅各的人来的时候呢，这里说彼得就怕这些。从雅各那边来的人，这些人是行律法的，那么他就赶快退去，不跟外邦人弟兄姐妹隔开了，不敢跟他们在一起了，也不敢跟他们一起吃饭了。
As this man of James came and saw Peter, and Peter immediately withdrew and separated himself because he knew that these are the people of the law.
那十三节，其他的犹太人呢，看到彼得也这样做。大家也跟着彼得这样做，然后大家也装假装傻，跟着彼得。
Verse 13, the rest of the Jews saw this and also played the hypocrite with Peter.
保罗甚至这里说，甚至连巴拿巴呀也跟着他们一起装假，跟着彼得这样装假。
And here Paul said that even Barnabas was also acting as the hypocrite.
本来这些人，其他犹太人啊，彼得啦、巴拿巴都没问题的，一起吃饭的，一起坐在一起的。什么问题都没有的呀。
Initially, all these people together with Barnabas, they were all having a meal with the Gentiles. There was no problem.
为什么看到从雅各那边来的人就完全不一样了，态度就不一样了呢？行为也不一样了呢？表现也不一样了呢？为什么？
How is it that they acted so differently as soon as the people of James came to this place?
14节。
Verse 14.
保罗一看见他们这种行为啊，这种表现啊，不正，跟福音的真理，主耶稣的救恩不符合，跟真理不符合。
And Paul saw that they were not straightforward or not upright in the presence of the truth.
就在众人面前直接的责备，指出彼得的错误，其他人的错误。
And in the presence of the congregation, he openly rebuked the mistake by Peter and others.
这件事是蛮严重的一下。
This was a very serious matter.
但是从保罗的这种这个书信当中写出来，就让我们很清楚知道，虽然彼得他们信了主耶稣，可是他们对那种律法观念啊，那种犹太教的那种观念，非常的执着，还是很强啊，还是很强呀。
From the writings of Paul in this episode, we can see that although they are all believers of Christ, and yet their understanding and also their roots in the Jewish customs and laws is very deep and strong.
那么十二节特别说，雅各就是这一般人的头啊，代表人物啊，从对律法的这种执着，这种坚持的雅各是代表人物啊，是他们的头来的呀。
And verse 12 here, it tells us that James was the representative or the important figure of these people.
啊，这个雅各就是主耶稣的兄弟，亲兄弟来的呀。
This James is also the blood brother of Jesus.
那从开会的这些对谈当中、表现当中，似乎雅各就是他们的领袖。我们用今天的话说，就是他们的总负责啊，他们的总负责来的。
The biological brother of Jesus, and from here we can deduce that he is actually the one of the chairperson or the important persons in charge of this community.
总负责。
The vice chairman or chairperson.
如果用今天的话来讲，就是总负责了，你没有翻译。
That is in today's terms.
好， 那谁敢得罪他呀？谁都要给脸他呀。
So who would dare to offend him?
如果确实是这样，你就知道这个组织，耶路撒冷这个组织，充满着仁义了。仁义已经很重了，不再是神的意思很重要了，人的意思很重要了。
We can see that in this organization of the Jews, it is full of man's will and man's intent.
这个是第一个我们看到的 example.
That's the first example.
啊，就是使徒观念，使徒们的观念自己都很强。
That the apostles' understanding or the concepts of this custom had been very deeply rooted.
第二种，第二个例子
，The second example.
就是记在《使徒行传》第十章。
That is recorded in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10.
当神叫彼得要去那个跟这个外邦人这个哥尼流啊传福音受洗的时候，他好像很为难啊，好像很作难，很作难啊。
That is when God instructed Peter to preach the gospel to the Gentile Cornelius, and Peter found it so difficult and such a challenge to do so.
我们怎么知道彼得有这样的问题呢？有这样的作难呢
？How do we know that Peter was actually finding it very difficult to preach to the Gentiles？
你跟我不知道，但是神知道。
You and I would not know, but God knew.
所以在第十章记录到，彼得上去祷告的时候，神就用异象来告诉他，来打破他这种律法的观念，这种犹太教的观念。
And that's why in chapter 10, we can see that the Lord God allowed Peter to see in a vision in order to break his mental barrier regarding the Jewish customs and laws.
所以十章九节到十六节不是彼得不是看到异象吗？祷告的时候看到天开的有一个大布降下来，里面包着很多装着很多的各种各样的动物在里面，有没有？
And don't we see in chapter 10, verse 9 to verse 12, and we can see that a great sheet came from heaven, and inside it wrapped with a lot of different animals of the earth.
他不明白这个是什么意思呀。
He did not understand what that meant.
一直到有声音对他说，彼得起来宰了吃，叫彼得宰这些动物来吃。
Until a voice came to him that Peter, kill and eat.
彼得对主耶稣说，主啊，不可以啊。这些不洁净的动物我们是不吃的，我也不吃的呀。他是守律法的，守旧约律法的。
And Peter was shocked and he said, Not so, Lord, I have never eaten anything common or unclean according to the law.
那第二次声音又在跟他说，起来宰了吃，因为神所洁净的你不可以当作 是不洁的。
Then a voice came to him the second time and asked him, Rise and kill and eat, for what God has cleansed, you must not call common.
已经应该很清楚了吧?
This is very clear to us now.
第一次神叫他吃。
The first time the Lord God instructed him to eat,
他说我不吃的。
He said, No, I don't.
第二次神又叫他吃,他第二次也是拒绝说我不吃的。
The second time he also declined to eat it.
一直到十六节说第三次神在叫他宰了吃。
Until verse 16, that the Lord God instructed him the third time.
知道那个异象哈，那个动物被收回天去，那个异象被收回去。
Until the object of the vision was been taken back up to heaven.
所以你就看这件事情嘛，彼得的那个犹太观念是多么的强，多么的顽固。神给他看异象，叫他吃一二三，一次两次三次，他都不太愿意的呀，他都不太愿意的呀。
We can see that, that Peter was so staunch in his understanding of the Jewish customs and the laws, and so much so that the Lord God instructed him so many times, he declined to eat it.
这个是事实有根据的呀。
All these have been proven.
虽然说是信了主了，也明白现在是在新约了，外邦人也得到救恩了，可是那个观念，旧观念很强啊，还没有全部都拿走啊，没有啊。
Although they have already believed in Christ and they understand that the Gentiles do also have the opportunity to be saved, and yet their traditional mindset has not been broken.
所以对付逼迫那些说希利尼化的基督徒，这个讲法是可以考虑的，是可以成立的。
And therefore, this third theory about the persecution was only targeting the Hellenist-speaking Jews. This explanation is actually reasonable.
就可以明白为什么除了使徒们好像没有受到逼迫攻击，为什么啊，就可以解释这一点，也可以进入里面去了解更多的事情，更多更深里面的一些事情。
And then by this theory and explanation, we can also understand that behind the surface of these apostles, we can see what is deeply rooted in them.
你看彼得得到主耶稣的启示过后，他当然要顺服嘛，他就去找哥尼流。你看他一进到哥尼流的家的时候，你看他第一句话讲什么？你注意看。
And after the revelation from the Lord Jesus, Peter had to go to visit Cornelius and look at what he how he reacted when he saw Cornelius.
使徒行传十章啊。
Actually, Apostle chapter 10.
那就是二十二十二十四节啊，二十四节开始啊。
Verse 24 onwards.
我们就时间关系，我们直接读28节吧。
Let's jump to verse 28.
彼得一进入到这个哥尼流的家，就对他说："你们知道哦，犹太人跟别国的人亲近，本是不合离的。"我们没有这样的规矩的，我们没有这样的风俗的，我们没有这样的行为的。一进人家的家，就说我们跟你们没有来往的。
The first time, the first moment he stepped into the house of Cornelius, then he said that you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to come in.
哎，有没有搞错？你进人家的家，人家接待你第一句话，你这样讲，你分得太清楚了吧？你觉得自己好像很圣洁，我们是外邦人，你何必讲这种话呢？
Don't you find it so rude and so curt of him as the visitor coming to the house of someone else and thinking he is so superior?
讲得这么强的话，这么硬的话，后来他才解释说，但是因为神哦指示我哦怎么样怎么样怎么样，所以我才来的呀，因为神启示我，我才来的呀。
And after introducing that phrase, then Peter only explained that God has shown me that I should come here.
我看这个彼得啊，实在是很硬哦，讲话很硬哦，观念也很硬，头脑也很硬，讲话也很硬。
Then we can see that Peter must be someone who has a very rigid and traditional mindset.
老实说，如果是今天的人啊，今天的脾气好像哥尼流的脾气不好，那算哦，你不想跟我们来往，你们没有跟我们来往，那你们有这种方式，那就算哦，你何必来呢？那你就走吧。如果生气起来，真的会讲这样的话。
Had Cornelius been someone who was who had a bad temper, then he would probably just say, "Okay, fine. Since you do not welcome us, you can just leave this place."
今天传道举出这些例子，这些哈情形，就要告诉大家，只逼迫说希律尼话的信徒哈是可以考虑，可以思考一下的。
Today, the preacher is sharing with you all these examples so that I can help you understand that it is reasonable for of the third argument that they only attack the Hellenic-speaking Jews.
你就知道为什么使徒们没有受到怎么样的逼迫。
Then you can also understand why is it that the apostles were not the targets of the persecution.
然后还有一个例子，一个 example.
There's also a historical example.
不是所有的信徒都分散离开耶路撒冷，不是。
In fact, not all members in Jerusalem were all scattered.
至少留下来的全部是讲本土话的纯犹太人，就不用离开。离开的是说希律尼话的那些犹太人。
Those who actually stayed and did not depart from Jerusalem were those who were local, locally bred and raised Jews.
我们的根基在哪里呢？
Where can we find this basis?
根基是《使徒行传》21章。
Exodus Apostles chapter 21.
我们读17节到20节。
We read verse 17 to 20.
我这里说，保罗他们到了耶路撒冷的时候呢，弟兄姐妹都欢欢喜喜接待他们。
It tells us that when Paul and the apostles came to Jerusalem, then the brethren received them gladly.
那到第二天的时候呢，他们也带保罗去见雅各啦，就是那个阿桃啦，他们的头啦。
On the following day, they went along to meet James, the so-called chairperson.
还有其他的长老哈，耶路撒冷的长老也在里面呢。
Together with the Jewish elders of Jerusalem.
那么保罗就跟他们问安，打个招呼，然后就讲了一些神在外邦教会的一些神迹，一些作为。
And Paul had greeted them and told them in detail the works of God in the Gentile lands.
你注意看20节他们在讲什么。
Take note in verse 20, how did they react to that?
来，我们看二十节。
Verse 20.
他们听见神在外邦教会的那些神迹，那些作为，就荣耀归给神，这个没问题。
They heard it that glorified the Lord God, and there's no issue with this.
但是他接下来讲什么，知道吗？
What did they say then?
那些长老呢，就对保罗说，兄台，兄弟啊，你看，犹太人中，本土的犹太人中，信主的有多少万啊，就是指在耶路撒冷有多少万在这里信耶稣啊。
This elder,
并且他们都为律法来热心的。
This elder,
这些本土犹太人都是为律法为谋，是一个很热心的，到现在还是很热心啊。
To Paul, that the brother, how many myers of Jews they are who have believed, and they are all zealous for the law.
这里你看到什么呢？
What do you see of this verse?
我看到保罗在称颂神在外邦中的作为，神对外邦人的恩典跟神迹，给的恩典跟神迹。
Well, I see that Paul was giving praise to God of God's works in the Gentile land.
这个耶路撒冷的高层领袖啊，这些长老使徒们啊，好像雅各咯。这些他们突然间讲，这里犹太，这里耶路撒冷很有几万犹太人的信徒啊，他们对律法很热心的，你这样讲是什么意思哦？我在讲外邦人的见证，你跟我讲犹太人很热心，很热心律法，哎，什么意思哦？
These elders, including James, being the leaders of the Jewish community, they then said that there are still myriad of Jews here, zealous for the law. What does that actually imply?
而且从第八章到今天的二十，现在我们看的二十章应该经过一段很长的时间了吧？应该有好几年了吧？
Reading from chapter 8 to chapter 21, it should be able to take some long duration of time, a few years maybe.
到这里我们看到留在耶路撒冷的为律法很热情的信徒有几万人没有离开耶路撒冷的，所以很肯定的，很肯定的，当时第八章离开的分散到各地的是朔西利尼化的信徒。
So he also tells us that there were many myriads of Jews who were still in Jerusalem, which also goes to explain to us that that those who were scattered from Jerusalem earlier were probably only some of the Jews.
对不起，我用比较多时间解释这一点，对不起。
I'm sorry, I have to elaborate on this with a lot more time.
因为很少人讲到这一点，也很少人不太敢提这一点。
Because there were very few speakers who would share about this point.
但事实上是这样子，我们看圣经前后文跟发生的经过跟所讲的话所表现的确实是有这个问题存在的。
But this is the truth, which is also the reality that happened with historical facts, and this problem actually existed.
那么我要讲的目的是在哪里呢？
But what is my purpose of telling you?
目的是圣经给我们看到当时耶路撒冷教会的组织是不完全的。
My purpose of telling you this is that the Jewish organization was not perfect.
可是这些领导人，这些有权柄、有能力的人呢，是耶路撒冷教会的带领人来的，是使徒们来的，是长老们来的。他们这种犹太观念这么强，仁义这么强，仁义强过神的意思，强过圣灵的意思。
And this organization in Jerusalem, even in the church and among the leaders and also powerful people in the church, there has such strongly rooted mindset and values of the Jewish customs. That consists of the elders and the apostles.
那么雅各呢，就是这一班人，这一群人啊，仁义很重的这一群人的代表性人物，他们的领导人。
This.James had also been such a strong and symbolic person or chairperson to represent the values of men, or so-called the mindset and the will of men.
这个让我们真的吓惊讶吓到一下。我在看在研究的时候，在深入去看的时候，我自己又吓了一下。
When I was studying this and researching on this, I was also taken aback.
因为前面都看到圣灵带领教会，他们又怎么样的顺服圣灵，又怎么样的荣耀神，又怎么样的同心。可是到第八章却隐藏着这个危机的存在，隐藏着原来我们说的总会啦，我们说的总会里面这么强的仁义在里面带领教会。
And because earlier we have read that the Holy Spirit guided them and the people were so united, obeyed God and they glorified God so much. And yet in this chapter, we can see that there's such a crisis where there's such strong will of man in the leadership organization.
如果是靠着一般人哦，包括使徒们来让福音传到外邦，我看很难哦，要等到何年何月哦。
If we were to rely on this group of people to wait for the gospel to be preached to the Gentile lands, then we will wait forever for this.
我们要等使徒哦来传，也应该很难哦，因为主耶稣交代说要把福音传到外邦，他们不很聚集，他们的态度不是很聚集。
And in fact, the Lord Jesus has instructed them to preach the gospel in all lands, and including the Gentile lands, and the apostles must find it very difficult to do that because they are not very active on the proactive.
所以神只好哦，借助这个撒旦的逼迫，本来要摧毁教会的，神却借助这种逼迫来转变，成为把福音传到外邦去。这个是神的智慧，神很高超的智慧。
And now we can see the wisdom of God himself, who actually has the wisdom to turn this crisis around from the persecution of Satan with the intent to destroy the church and to the spreading of the gospel in Gentile lands.
对第八章接下去都不再讲使徒的工作，都在讲腓力哦，福音怎样传到外邦去，信徒怎样去传福音，都讲都在讲这些哦，都不再讲使徒们的工作呀。
From chapter 8 onwards, then we can see that there's a change of focus. There's no longer about the work of the apostles, but the work of the gospel to the Gentile lands.
一直到第九章的时候，神又兴起在拣选这个保罗来做外邦人的福音使徒，都不再跟那些使徒讲。And
yet in chapter 9, we see the focus that Paul was elected especially in order to preach the gospel to the Gentiles, and no longer was the focus on the apostles.
这个是我们在看使徒行传的时候，我们很少去发现，或者发现了也不太敢去解释的事情，不太敢去动它的一件事情。
This is something that as we read the Acts of the Apostles, we may not find notice, or even after we have noticed that, we do not dare to raise an issue with that.
简单说，使徒们是不是忽略了主耶稣的吩咐了？有一点对主耶稣有了一些亏欠了，老实说。
And in fact, that is to put it simply, the apostles have neglected and have fallen short of the expectation of the Lord Jesus.
在使徒行传第一章，神不是主耶稣不是交代吗？升天之前，哦，圣灵降在你们身上，你们就能得到能力。And
didn't the Lord Jesus instruct them that when the Holy Spirit come upon you in chapter 2 or chapter 1, that they will find strength as the Holy Spirit descends on them.
并且你们要在耶路撒冷、犹太全地，还有撒玛利亚，特别指出是撒玛利亚，就是外邦他们看不起的这一群人，看不起的这个城市，要到那边去做见证，去传福音给他们。
And that they shall become witnesses to the Lord Jesus in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, which is a Gentile country.
都好像是不是忘了，或者不太积极去做这件事了。
It appeared that the apostles had forgotten, or they were not very proactive on this matter.
所以神只好借助这个逼迫哦，顺水推舟啊，顺这个水推那个船，让顺水把福音传出去吧。借这个逼迫的时候。 就不再是借助使徒们了，借助逼迫，借助那些分散的信徒。
And therefore, the Lord God has wisely utilized this persecution or this crisis in order to fulfill this part of His will.
这是神的智慧。This
is the wisdom of God.
这也是看到当人不太积极配合神的工作的时候，神有他另一个方法，神会用其另一些人。
It also reveals to us that as men are not very proactive in carrying out the word of God, the Lord God has other ways to fulfill His work.
所以在这件事情上，我们看到，就算是受到撒旦的逼迫，原来里面也存着有神更美的旨意在里面，更美好的旨意在里面。
We can also see that although this is the persecution of Satan against the church, and yet there is a beautiful will of God and the plan of God behind it.
哦，真的像罗马书说的，万事互相效力，一定有它的功效的，有它的作用的。哦，特别是对那些爱神的人，一定有它的帮助的。
especially which also proves to us the words in the book of Romans that all things work for the for good for those who for those who believe him.
你们还记得传道在一开始就问一个问题吗？
Do you remember my first question when I started the sermon?
这个问题就是为主为福音殉道的不是使徒，反而是司提反，是那个做打杂的管理四方的那个执事。为主殉道的第一个殉道却是他，不是使徒。
I told you this answer. I told you this situation that the first person to martyr to die for the Lord Jesus was not the apostles, but the caretaker or a person in charge who was lowly, Deacon Stephen.
到第八章的时候又看到福音传到各地去，不是使徒去传，反而是那些受逼迫的信徒，受逼迫的信徒去传。
As we come into chapter 8, that the ones who preach the gospel to the Gentile lands were not the apostles, but the Jews who have been persecuted.
那一次传到撒玛利亚这个城市的时候，这个犹太人很讨厌的这个城市的时候，是七个执事中的腓力去传的，也不是使徒。
And even the person who have preached the gospel to Samaria, a city whom the Jews hated, was actually by Philip, but not the apostles.
对，这有两个重点呢。
And this tells us two important points.
第一，为主殉道。
First one, to martyr for Christ.
第二，把福音传到外邦人身上。
Secondly, to preach the gospel to the Gentiles.
这两件事，使徒们都没有站在第一位。
In these two matters alone, the apostles were not the ones carrying out the work.
使徒们都是跟在信徒的后面。注意听哦，是跟在信徒的后面，信徒在前面做这两件事情。
On these two matters, the apostles have slacked behind the believers of the church, and the believers were given credit on these two matters.
这是我看到的事实。
This is actually the fact I can see.
不知道你的感想又是什么？不知道你看到的又是什么？
I'm not too sure how you feel about this.
我可能有些人很难接受我这样的解释，或者不太愿意这样接受。但事实是这样啊，兄弟，事实是这样。
There may be some people who do not accept my explanation, but this turned out to be the reality that happened.
所以我们还是接受事实吧，我们用谦卑的心，用反省的心接受事实吧。
Let's have a heart of humility and also a reflection to receive to accept the reality of things.
那时候我们都有软弱，我们都有私心，我们都有很强的仁义，包括使徒们也有软弱，也有私心，也有很强的自己的意思。简单讲就是这样。
Because we, and as well as the apostles back then, we all still have our selfish interests as well as our the will of man in us.
简单说，我们不是众人想象中那么完美。哇，长老执事，哇，传道哦，我们不是你们想象中这么完美、这么完全呐、啊，没有啦。
To put it simply, we are not as perfect or as holy as the people thought we were.
所以使徒们也没有我们想象中的这么完美了，没有了。
And so are the apostles are not perfect and not holy as we thought they were.
但是圣灵会帮助我们呢。
But the Holy Spirit would guide us.
圣灵也一直在改变他们啊，甚至指责他们啊，感动他们啊，一直到后来越来越完全，越来越完美，越来越把人的意思拿掉，完全顺服神，顺服圣灵。那是后来一直在看到的，后来一直在看到的一种改变，使徒们的改变。
We can also see how the Holy Spirit was transforming the apostles gradually and moving their hearts and rebuking them so much so that in the latter part of their story, they became more and more perfect and more complete for the gospel of God.
我们今天也是当传道，也是不是你们想象中这么完美的。我们也是一直在悔改的，我们也是一直要用道理神的道理来督责我们、责备我们、警告我们。提醒我们，我们都一直要做悔改工作的，我们都是一直要做悔改的工作的。
Even as preachers, we are also not perfect, and we have to continuously seek the Holy Spirit to rebuke us, to reprimand us, to admonish us, so that we are able to do the work of repentance.
所以你看到启示录到最后的时候，最后一段的时候呢，主耶稣是叫我们洗衣服，努力洗衣服，把衣服洗干净的，最后就是这样。
Which is why in the book of Revelation, the last part where the Lord Jesus commanded us, instructed us to wash our garments, to wash our garments. This is what it means.
这是对所有的人讲的，不只有信徒啊，长老、执事、传道，全部人都要洗衣服啊。
This is not spoken. This is spoken to everybody, not just the preachers, not just the ministers, but everyone has to wash our garments.
啊，我们今天讲了这么多，就是从为什么圣经说除了使徒以外，其他信徒被分散。我们从里面发现到了这个问题，教会的不完整，耶路撒冷教会的不完全，以及跟使徒们的不完全。
And we are able to understand this from this historical background that the reason why some of the Jews as well as the apostles were not scattered and they were also not persecuted, it reveals to us the crisis of imperfection and in the organization of the church in Jerusalem.
我想讲这三种解释就够了。
I believe that these three types of explanation or theories would suffice.
其他的解释不用讲了啦，都是不用讲了。
I will not go on to on other theories.
那我们从这次的大逼迫当中，我们看到神的智慧，看到神的旨意，看到真神的作为。从这个逼迫中看到神的智慧，看到神的旨意，看到真神的作为。
And here we can see that from this crisis that we can see the wisdom of God, the will of God, and also the work of God.
如果你从表面上去看呢，我们看到撒旦是成功的，因为把耶路撒冷的信徒逼到离开，逼到走掉。你从表面看是撒旦的逼迫是成功的，因为本来住在那边的都走掉了，散掉了。
And yet from the surface or from a superficial level of it, it is as though Satan was victorious because he has successfully cast away or persecuted the Jews and make them all scatter.
但是你深入进去看的时候，你却发现其实撒旦是失败的，非常失败的。
But as you dive deeper into the reality, and you can realize that Satan was most defeated.
神是胜利的，教会是胜利的。
And the Lord God was victorious, the church was victorious.
因为里面有神的旨意啊，有神的作为啊。
Because there is the will of God, there is also the work of God.
简单说，看好像是失败，其实是得胜。
Simply put, it looked as though they failed, but in fact they have been victorious.
好像十字架的救赎工作看起来主耶稣是失败的，被钉死了，其实是胜利的。
Just like the salvation work of the Lord Jesus on the cross, it looked as though he failed, but in fact it was his victory.
再来看这次的逼迫。看起来是失败的、哦、门徒散掉了、信徒散掉了，但其实是把福音带到各地去的。
And in this persecution that happened here, it looked as though the members have all scattered, and it looked that have failed. In fact, this is how the Lord God wanted the gospel to be preached.
所以无论从圣经上看，还是从我们真耶稣教会的历史过程来看，许多魔鬼的工作、魔鬼的破坏、魔鬼的攻击。反倒使教会更加兴旺，神的荣耀更大的彰显。
From the biblical records as well as historical findings, that we can validate that many works of the devil that were targeting the church had also turned out to be the victories of the church, where the church continued to become more and more victorious.
这个可以从圣经上去看得到，也可以从我们教会的经过发展的历史可以看到。
This is what we can find in the Bible as well as in the history of the development of the church.
反而今天是很平安的生活，很平安的日子，很舒服的这个日子，却看不到这种神的荣耀，看不到这种福音的这种力量，看不到，很少了，很少。
In our times of peace and comfort, such as today, we are unable to see the good works of God, and we have little chance to find the great wonders of God.
怪不得主耶稣在讲泛滥的时候，在讲灾难的时候，在讲逼迫的时候，耶稣突然讲一句话，主耶稣说，这些事是必须有的，是需要的。
Which is why the Lord Jesus actually told us that tribulations and persecutions and all these adversities would come upon us, and all this must come to pass.
一般当的人不明白主耶稣这句话的。
Generally, people would not understand the rationale of these words.
这种泛滥、这种灾难、这种逼迫是不好的嘛？为什么必须要呢？
Why does the Lord God want us to suffer all these persecutions and adversities like this? These are all bad things.
但是主耶稣却相反说, 这必须有,
But yet the Lord Jesus has said the opposite, that this must come to pass.
有没有? 耶稣有没有这样讲?
Didn't the Lord Jesus say that?
请看马太福音书24章,
you turn to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 24.
第六节,
Verse 6, that all these tribulations and disasters must come to pass.
就好像今天的世界性的这种病毒风暴，新冠这个病毒的问题。
Just like the pandemic of the COVID-19.
这些泛滥真的是有时是必须要有。
These tribulations are necessary.
人才会谦卑下来。
Only then will man be able to humble ourselves.
人才会去思考一些信仰的问题，特别是跟神的那些关系。
Only then man would be able to reflect on the relationship with God as well as matters regarding to their faith.
如果用圣经的角度来看，为什么要必须有？
And from the biblical perspective, why is this necessary?
理由很多啦，原因很多啦。
There are many reasons.
我讲两个。
Let me point to you two reasons.
因为这个泛滥逼迫来到的时候，要把我们分别出来。
As the tribulations come upon us, we will be separated or divided.
真的信仰跟假的信仰分别出来。
Divided in a sense between those who hold on to the true faith and those who hold on to the false faith.
真的麦子跟假的麦子把它分别出来。
To differentiate between the wheat and also the grain.
我们怎么知道呢?
How do we know that?
保罗在哥林多前书三章说，有火化现，有火出来烧我们。火一烧的时候，就把我们的品质，真的假的，全部烧出来了。
Between the wheat and the tares, and as these tribulations come, Paul said that this fire will come upon us to burn our true qualities.
你是真信主还是假信主烧出来了？你是站在神那一边的，还是站在人那一边的？就把你烧出来了，事情一发生就知道了，就看到了。
Whether you are a true believer or a false believer, as the fire comes upon you and consumes you, you will be able to show and reveal your true self.
这是在记载哥林多前书三章十二节到十三节里面保罗所解释的。
And this is also what is recorded in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 12 to 13 that is explained by Paul.
没有这个火出来烧，谁知道啊？自己也不知道自己的信仰是这样啊，还以为很好，还以为很爱神，还以为很忠心啊。
If the fire did not come upon us to consume us and burn us, it looked as though everyone was so loyal and so faithful.
所以大逼迫各种泛滥来到是有需要的，因为要分别，把真假分出来。Which
is why there is a necessity for tribulations and persecutions to come upon us, so that we are able to differentiate between the true and the false.
第二个原因。The
second reason.
当泛滥逼迫来到的时候呢，神的目的是要我们回家，借着这种逼迫灾难，让我们回家。
As tribulations and disasters come upon us, it is in order for God to bring us home.
就好像圣经的那个浪子，遇到灾难了，遇到泛滥了，遇到没得吃了，痛苦了，走投无路了，逼他回家，催这种灾难，催他回家，逼他回家。Likened
to the prodigal son in the Bible, that as soon as he ran out of means and he was met with adversities and challenges, he could find no other way but to return home.
以前他根本不想回家的。Previously,
he did not want to go home.
甚至他还有没有家，他都到底还有没有他的家，他都已经忘了，都已经不知道了。
So much so that he has forgotten whether he had a home or not.
每天就是在享受，每天就在讲赚钱啊，每天就在讲快乐而已啊。
And he was all busy every day with the matters of enjoyment, pleasures, and also earning money.
当灾难痛苦来到的时候，他才想起啊，我还有一个家，我还有家呀，我要回家呀。
But as sufferings and persecution come upon him, he realized that I have a home and I want to return to my home.
好像现在的病毒也是一样，那很多人才想到哦，哦，这个世界的灾难、世界的危险、生命的脆弱，才想到要有神的保护，要有神的看顾，要有神的平安，要敬拜真神，不是这样子吗？
Like unto the pandemic crisis today, that as soon as this hits us, some of us actually come to realization that we are all fragile, and the fragility of life brought us closer to find God.
所以患难呢，是神的怜悯，神催那些浪子回家，给他们回家。
Which is why tribulations such as these are the mercy of God, and trying to remind the prodigal sons to return home.
我听传道同工台湾传道同工说，台湾921大地震的时候，那段日子，教会很多信徒啊，有一些信徒没有看过，不懂从那里跑出来的，晚间聚会也做到满满的呀。他很感动啊，讲道理都觉得很感动啊，这么多信徒不知道从那里来的。
This reminded me of the testimony shared by a co-worker in Taiwan Church, where from the great earthquake on the 21st of September, many members suddenly just swarmed into the church out of nowhere, so much so that they don't even recognize who they were.
Because 那时大家都感受到生命随时都会死亡，而且没有平安，没有盼望，没有依靠，很怕。
In these times of crisis, that they were finally fearful that their lives would be lost, and they were most afraid.
一些朋友、一些亲戚就这样死掉了。
Some of their friends and relatives have already died from that.
那想到的就是神，想到的就是回来教会。
And all they could think of would be God and to return to the church.
可是灾难过了，平安了，又不见了，这些人又不见了。
But as soon as the earthquake or the disasters passed, these people disappeared.
所以遇到苦难，好像第八章的大逼迫，这种逼迫我们要去思考了，要去反省，里面神的意思是什么，要去思考。
Just like the adversity and the persecution that happened in Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, what is the will of God for us? We have to think about that.
特别是为什么让我或者我的家人受到这样的苦难，要去思想。
Especially to why God wanted and allowed such persecutions and difficulties to come on me and my family.
为何主耶稣说是必须要有的？
And why is it that the Lord Jesus said that it must come to pass?
所以不要一直想为什么主耶稣让我受苦啊？为什么主耶稣没有帮助我啊？为什么主耶稣怎么样怎么样？不要一直讲为什么，你要去想。遇到患难的时候，是主耶稣爱我，是主耶稣要救我，是主耶稣要提醒我。你为什么不这样想呢？
You have to stop complaining that why has God done this to me and allowed this to happen to me and my family and my beloved ones? And we must, on the other hand, start thinking that the Lord, this is the way the Lord God is trying to love us and trying to save us.
好，那么我们今天就讲到第八章的一节了哈，这一节。
Today we will be concluding chapter 8, verse 1.
那么下一次星期我们讲第二节，第二节虔诚人把斯提凡埋葬这件事情。
And we will continue on verse 2 on the coming Tuesday evening, how the city is burying Stephen.
那么这里有什么 好讲的呢？
What is there to talk about in this verse?
星期二再听。
Let's find out on Tuesday.
好，我们来唱赞美诗。
We sing hymn.